Fuel cell batteries from which the orbiter gets its power, the shuttle gets its power, and so they've had to reconnect up the ground line to the shuttle to give it more power. So what we can be assured of is that there won't be a launch for at least 20 minutes.
Thank you, James. Well, probably we'll have news of that in the Ed Stewart programme. No doubt Ed will transfer the charges of the call to Cape Canaveral. Now it's time...
It's 2 o'clock. This is Chris Aldred at the Radio 2 News Desk. There's been a last-minute hitch at Cape Canaveral, which has delayed the launch of the Space Shuttle. It should have left the ground more than an hour ago, but then two problems cropped up. One with the fuel system, the other with a computer. For the latest news, we're going over live to James Wilkinson at the Cape Canaveral launch site.
We're still waiting for a new target time for a launch, but the space experts here haven't yet solved the computer problem. A short while ago, the launch controllers revealed that one of the computer packages, which is giving trouble, has never been tested in a simulation. No reasons have been given for this, but clearly there will be some very serious questions asked once the immediate problem has been solved. There are 5 computers on board, 4 of which are used during the ascent of the shuttle, and the other which is a backup. The problem is that the backup computer is not communicating with the other 4, and no one yet knows why. It is still possible for the launch to be held for a few more hours today. One of the limiting factors is the length of time the crew can remain lying on their backs. They've already been in this position for about 3 hours, and the doctors say they should not remain like that for more than 6 hours. And now back to Chris Aldred in the studio.
James Wilkinson at Cape Canaveral. There's been a new flare-up in the... The Space Shuttle Control at Cape Canaveral in Florida now say that the returnable spacecraft should be able to take off at about 20 minutes past 4 this afternoon, 3.5 hours later than planned. Engineers still haven't solved the 2 problems which delayed the launch, one concerning the fuel system and the other involving a computer. For the latest news, we're going over live to James Wilkinson at the launch site.
Well, it's now been announced, as you said, that the Space Shuttle may take off in about another hour and 20 minutes. But the problems with it are still not solved, and it's possible the launch may be postponed until Sunday. The continual delays have come as a big disappointment to the thousands of people who have gathered here. But there is still a chance it may get off today, and the countdown has been resumed. The earliest time for a launch is now set at 4:20 in the afternoon London time. One of the limiting factors the controllers are coming up against is the length of time the astronauts can lie on their backs with their legs in the air, as they are at the moment. They've already been in this position for about 4 hours, and the maximum the doctors will allow them is 6. The launch controllers are still working on the problem with the backup computer, which is not communicating with the other 4 computers on board, and hope that by 4:20 they will have solved the problem. Now back to Chris Aldred in London.
James Wilkinson at Cape Canaveral. Well, as the American scientists struggle with their problems over the renewal of space travel, the Russians are celebrating the 20th anniversary of their early space triumph. A new museum has opened in Moscow, and a special coin has been issued commemorating the first orbiting of the Earth by Yuri Gagarin on April the 12th, 1961. Soviet state-controlled newspapers, radio and television have been carrying extensive coverage of the anniversary. The Americans have just revealed that it was one of their submarines which collided with a Japanese cargo ship in the East China Sea yesterday. The ship sank with the loss of 2 of its crew. It's 4 o'clock and this is Chris Aldred at the Radio 2 News Desk. We've just heard that the launch has been called off for today. The result of the Fermanagh and South Tyrone by-election is due to be announced about now. It's been a straight fight between the Republican prison hunger striker Bobby Sands and the former unionist leader Harry West. There's been a turnout of nearly 87%. That's just a little below the figure at the last general election. Meanwhile, another IRA hunger striker at the Mays prison near Belfast has been transferred to the jail's hospital. Israeli planes of dates have admitted that it was one of them. Shuttle problems have been besetting America's ambitious scheme, already delayed several hours. It was hoped that the launch could be made in about 20 minutes from now after engineers had thought they'd ironed out the latest difficulties. But in the last few minutes, it was learnt it was not possible to continue the countdown. Well, that's all from now for now on Radio 2.
Join Robin Boyle at the Radio 2 News Desk.
Brixton is counting the cost this morning of yesterday's hours of rioting in which 165 policemen and a number of residents were hurt. Scientists at Cape Canaveral have high hopes that the rescheduled launch of the space shuttle will be able to go forward as planned in 3 hours' time. In fact, things are going so well that it might be advanced by a quarter of an hour. This will be designed to take advantage of clear weather. The forecasters say that later on it will get more cloudy. The two astronauts, John Young and Bob Crippen, have now been woken up and will very shortly be taking their seats in the shuttle. More than 1 million people are expected in the Cape Canaveral area to watch America's re-entry into space travel after a break of nearly 6 years.
Independent Radio News, it's 3.
Nations are confident that even if they don't know precisely what caused the computer problem, in the very unlikely event of it reoccurring, they now know how to deal with it. But one factor which is beyond the Space Administration's control is the weather, and that's something which is causing concern this morning. Unlike Friday, when the sky over Launch Pad 39A was completely clear, clouds have been spotted in the vicinity of Cape Canaveral. The launch can't proceed if more than 50% of the sky is obscured by cloud, in which case, depending on the forecast, the countdown would be suspended for up to 3 hours. If the weather still hasn't improved at the end of that period, then the launch would have to be postponed until tomorrow or Tuesday. But for the time being, at least, everyone's keeping their fingers crossed and hoping that that won't be necessary. Andrew Mandelstam, IRN at the Johnson Space Center, Houston.
In the race to get the first manned spaceship into orbit, from Moscow, John Moody reports.
It was 20 years ago that a 27-year-old test pilot named Yuri Gagarin soared into orbit around the Earth and opened the era of manned space travel. The Soviet Union won the race to put a man into space, but in the two decades since, the United States has caught up, and some believe forged ahead of the Russians in space research. The Soviet people commemorated Gagarin's flight this weekend with speeches, with a newly minted one-ruble coin bearing his likeness, but most of all with the pride on their faces when they speak of the first man in space. Gagarin was killed in a plane crash in 1968, but he is remembered as the greatest of modern Soviet heroes and a name for the history books. This is John Moody in Moscow.
Scientists at Cape Canaveral in the United States are confident that the launch of the space shuttle Columbia will now go ahead in 2 hours' time. The two astronauts are now inside the shuttle. Earlier, they had a big breakfast with space agency officials. One of our correspondents covering the event says that the weather prospects are good. We plan to have live coverage of the takeoff from Cape Canaveral.
Prince Charles... ...problems over this afternoon's planned launch of the space shuttle Columbia. This time, they're having difficulties with the oxygen supply to the two astronauts. But as Andrew Mandelstam reports, the countdown is still continuing, and the engineers are optimistic that the launch will go ahead.
Astronauts John Young and Bob Crippen were awoken shortly after 8 a.m. this morning and have had their traditional breakfast of steak, sausages, scrambled eggs and orange juice. The countdown is proceeding normally in what so far has been a repeat performance of Friday's launch attempt, with NASA officials keeping their fingers crossed that this time no last-minute snags occur. Technicians say they've solved in part the computer problem which caused the postponement, and should it reoccur, which they claim is very unlikely, they feel confident that they could deal with it quickly. One factor which is still causing concern is the weather. It's not as good as on Friday, and although conditions at this stage would not cause a delay of the launch, the forecasters are watching the situation very closely. Andrew Mandelstam, IRN at the Johnson Space Center, Houston.
In the Radio 2 News at 12, it's Robin Boyle. After all the delays and disappointments, everything is now set for the launch of the American space shuttle Columbia in an hour's time. The two astronauts are inside and the door's been sealed. From Cape Canaveral, Michael Vesti sets the scene.
This time, the countdown has gone so smoothly that launch control here have even been talking of a liftoff 15 minutes early. Though it seems likely the two astronauts will thunder into space at 1 o'clock as planned. One anxiety during the night was the weather, the fear that it might be too cloudy. But launch control believes the skies will be clear enough in an hour's time. John Young and Bob Crippen are now in their seats making final checks. One small problem cropped up. They found they were not receiving the proper flow of oxygen in the cabin, but that was quickly resolved. The darkness has given way to the dawn, and I can see the Columbia spacecraft gleaming in the spotlight 3 miles from where I'm sitting. It does now look as if the launch will take place on this, the 20th anniversary of the first manned spaceflight by the Russian Yuri Gagarin.
Now the aftermath of yesterday's
launch of the American space shuttle Columbia, due to take place at 1 o'clock this afternoon our time. Andrew Mandelstam reports.
The astronauts Bob Crippen and John Young have now been in the craft for just over 2 hours, and so far there's only been one minor mishap, as launch control explained.
That was after the crew had gotten into the cabin. When we tried to hook up the air hoses to their helmets, it was discovered that they were not getting air properly at their helmets. It turned out that the problem was in what is called a quick disconnect. It's a connection that's located underneath the seat, which is used for connecting the hose that moves to the helmet. The quick disconnect was not quite in the proper position, and a locking pin was not in place. They found that.
And the fault has now been rectified. The weather at Cape Canaveral is good, as at all the three emergency landing sites.
Andrew Mandelstam, IRN at the Johnson Space Center, Houston.
Father's rocket, huh?
Thank you, Pete. Well, with just a short time left before liftoff, let's just go through what happens in those last few seconds or so.
Right.
There's an awful lot of activity packed into the last moments before flight, and almost all of it is carried out automatically by computers. Let's hope they don't let us down this time. 30 seconds before liftoff, the computers are told by the people in the firing room to take over. From that moment, there's only one more human command necessary. That's given about 5 seconds before liftoff, when the order is given for the start-up of the shuttle's three main engines. They take only seconds to build up most of their thrust. And then finally, the computer ignites the two solid rocket boosters. These are the largest solid rocket boosters ever made, and they generate quite colossal power. Once they're lit, there's no turning back. They can't be switched off like the main engines can. They burn for 2 minutes regardless. Between them, all these engines generate some 2,800 tons of thrust. As for the flight itself, the shuttle's going to take about 12 minutes to get up to low orbit. About 2 minutes after liftoff, the solid rocket boosters will burn out and then separate from the shuttle. By that time, the shuttle will be 30 miles high. They'll come down by parachute into the Atlantic, where there are ships standing by to pick them up so they can be used again. Then, using just its three main engines, the shuttle will accelerate on up for the next 6.5 minutes. That will take it to a height of over 70 miles. At that stage, it will be out over the Atlantic, travelling at over 16,500 miles an hour. Once it's reached that speed and height, and used up all its liquid oxygen and liquid hydrogen, the fuel tank will be jettisoned. It'll tumble back into the Earth's atmosphere to break up and land in the Indian Ocean. That's the only part of the shuttle which is not reusable. At that stage, the shuttle's own smaller engines take over, and will carry the shuttle to its target altitude of 150 miles up, where it will go around the Earth in a circular orbit. Well, that's what should happen if everything goes according to plan. So it's fingers crossed.
Right, indeed. Well, thank you very much indeed, James Wilkinson. James Wilkinson at Cape Canaveral will be in contact again with us just before the space shuttle launch at 1 o'clock. So we'll be making contact at Cape Canaveral in the very near future. In the meantime, I see science correspondent at Cape Canaveral. Can you hear me all right, James?
Yes, thank you, Pete.
It's quite noisy in the background there, isn't it?
Well, it is quite a lot of noise here, yes. They've got the NASA commentary, you know, the tannoy going in the background, and there are many thousands of journalists and people here all working away, typing away and so on, so there's quite a bit of noise.
What about the public? How near can they get to it?
Well, the public, some of the public are actually on the site here. Those are the lucky ones who applied a long time ago for tickets to come here. There are about 80,000 visitors actually on the site itself, including a number of celebrities, representatives of various governments and so on. But the public who haven't got into the centre, they're going to look at it from the roads that are surrounding the space centre here. It's a very flat area. It's actually a swamp. So there's you can see the shuttle for miles around. And the roads have been absolutely jammed this morning. People camping out. In fact, some people have been camping out on the roadside since last Friday to make sure they're getting a good view of it.
There were some doubts about the weather. How is that?
Well, the weather's absolutely magnificent this morning. There were concerns earlier on. The forecasters were saying that there might be half cloud cover. That means, you know, half the sky covered in cloud, which was a marginal factor. If that had been the case, the thing couldn't have got off. But the sun rose about an hour ago. There's barely a cloud in the sky, just a little bit of wispy cloud on the horizon. Sun is strong and bright, and it's a really beautiful morning here.
In fact, what is the time there?
Well, the time here is about just before 10 to 7. We're about 6 hours behind you.
Yes, that's right. I just wanted to check on that. There's no recurrence, I take it, of the computer problem?
No, the computer problem has been solved. There were one or two slight hitches during the countdown. There was a slight problem with the oxygen flow into the cabin, but that's been solved very quickly, and everything's gone almost without a hitch.
Do you have any news on the astronauts themselves?
Well, they are in the shuttle now, of course. They got in about an hour and a half ago. They were said to be feeling well and fit. We saw them on the monitor screens here, suiting up and going into their white van to be taken down to the launch pad. The access hatch has been shut some time ago, and so everything is, they're just waiting. Everything is fine. The clock stands at T-minus 9 minutes. That's because we are holding at the moment. We'll be coming out of a hold shortly. In a couple of minutes, the access arm will be retracted. And then at just about 5 minutes before liftoff comes quite a crucial point. That's when they stop topping up the liquid oxygen in the fuel tank. And from that moment on, if there's any problem, they can't hold the launch for longer than just a few minutes,
without having to backtrack on the countdown and start it at an earlier stage. But no one is talking about problems here, and at T-minus 9, everything is going fantastically well.
Good. Well, we're, once again, as you said earlier on, keep our fingers crossed. And we'll be coming back to you, James, after we've played some music, all right? Can you hear? Okay with you?
Yes, that's fine.
Fine, lovely. Bye.
Rolling my sweet baby song. Rolling my sweet baby song. Gonna lay around the shack till the mail train comes back. Rolling my sweet baby song.
Terrific stuff. Charlie McCoy rolling in my sweet baby's arms. We'll be returning to James Wilkinson at Cape Canaveral after we played another piece of music, and I'm sure it's all a very exciting time for everybody over there. I must say, I wish I was with him. But I'm delighted at the same time to send out some greetings to people here in Britain. Mrs. H. Tipping, for example, of 6 Gunter Road, Weatherby in Yorkshire. Today it is her birthday. Mrs. Tipping, happy birthday. Also the wedding anniversary of her son Nigel and his wife Janice. On the same day, that is today, it is the wedding anniversary of Janice's mum and dad, Joan and Douglas Baker of Bridgewater in Somerset. And Nigel and Janice live in Harrogate, and they'll be christening their second daughter, Elizabeth Clare, on Easter Sunday down in Bridgewater. Congratulations to you all, and happy birthdays and wedding anniversaries, respectively. A happy birthday, too, to Mr. Jack Anderson of Great Bridgefield in Staffordshire, and lots of love from your daughter, Brenda, and indeed son-in-law, Bill. And we offer you our congratulations. Looking forward to your party. Well, I think you had your party last night. I hope it went well. And then Peggy Hawkins of 55 Keyhaven Road, Milford-on-Sea, would like us to play a record for her nephew, who is celebrating his 26th birthday tomorrow. His name is Gregory Martin, and he's in Ward 10 of Mount Vernon Hospital, northward in Middlesex. And we wish you, Gregory Martin, a very happy birthday today, and lots of love. And also thanks to the wonderful staff who look after you. I'm sure you'd like to add that greeting as well as Peggy. And for you all, we have the BBC Midland Radio Orchestra, conducted by Ian Sutherland. I get a kick out of you. ¶¶ that was I get a kick out of you by the BBC Midland Radio Orchestra conducted by Ian Sutherland. It's just over 2 minutes before take off, so to speak. So back to James Wilkinson, our BBC science correspondent at Cape Canaveral. All right, James?
Thank you, Pete. Well, at last, we're within 2 minutes of the launch, and excitement has reached fever pitch here. Surely nothing can go wrong now. The engines have all just been through their last checks. The liquid hydrogen in the fuel tank has been brought up to flight pressure. The astronauts John Young and Bob Crippen now very tense as liftoff approaches. Crippen has been an astronaut for many years, of course, but this is his first trip into space. John Young, on the other hand, is a very experienced astronaut. This will be his fifth trip into space, his last one being a lengthy stay on the moon's surface. If anything goes wrong, the astronauts could either eject from the shuttle, or they could bring it back to a landing here at the Cape. Or if things are not quite so bad, they could go just once around the Earth and land on a dry lake bed in New Mexico. About 10 seconds before liftoff, the controllers will start the sound suppression system at the launch pad. This consists of the thousands of gallons of water which will cascade out of hoses, spraying the ground beneath the shuttle. The purpose of this is to cut back the amount of sound which is reflected off the launch pad soon after liftoff. Now we welcome Radio 4 listeners who've just joined us. The sound of this rocket is so loud that if it bounced back onto the shuttle, it could cause serious damage. The noise from this liftoff is going to be even louder than the noise from the Saturn V moon rocket. Now, T-minus 45 seconds, the space shuttle just 3 miles away from me, looking marvelously white in the sun. The weather is ideal. The main engine on the shuttle will start some 3 seconds before the solid rocket boosters, and then almost immediately this extraordinary-looking vehicle will leave the ground, lifted into the air by over 2,500 tons of thrust. T-minus 21 seconds, and only a short while to go now before launch. T-minus 17 seconds. Let's go to the NASA commentary and join them.
13. T-minus 10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4. We've gone for main engine start. We have main engine start.
And it's away, rising painfully slowly off the launch pad, and it's cleared the tower, and any moment, and here's the roar of the engines and the roar of the crowd here as they wish it well on its way, and here's the engine roar. It's making the very ground beneath me shake. 2,500 tons of thrust is now powering the shuttle up through the atmosphere, accelerating all the time, and the noise is getting louder and louder. 30 seconds into the flight, travelling at several hundred miles an hour, and it's twisting slightly and curving gently over away from us, out over into the over the Atlantic, and the tails of orange flame are making a fantastic noise, and the shuttle itself is accelerating away, getting smaller and smaller all the time, and the noise is gently dying down now, and the astronauts should be talking to Mission Control. It's coming up to 57, 58, 60 seconds into the flight, the most critical moment of the launch. The big question is whether the shuttle will be able to stand the enormous pressure now building up. This was the critical point, but everything does seem to be going well. It's now getting further and further away, travelling at well over 1,000 miles an hour now and accelerating all the time. The speed with which this has almost disappeared out of sight has been quite extraordinary, generating tremendous G-forces on the astronauts. There's a huge column of smoke, and the smoke billowing out from the launch pad still. In about 45 seconds or so, the two big rockets on either side of the shuttle should have used up all their fuel, and when that happens, they'll separate from the shuttle and parachute back to Earth. And we can pick up the shuttle now on the television monitor screens being filmed from a high-flying aircraft. It's completely out of sight of us on the ground. All we can see is a huge column of smoke and steam. Any moment now, it's just a faint pinprick in the sky, and any moment now we should have the separation of the main rockets. Still waiting for confirmation, T plus 2 minutes into the flight. A few seconds now and the solid rocket motor should separate. We can see it on the television monitoring screens, and we can see the flames coming out of the rockets. And there they go, the rockets have separated. And the shuttle's main engines now will take it up to a height of over 70 miles before the main fuel tank comes away to drop back into the Indian Ocean. That should take place in about another 5 minutes. Well, we're still left with this huge column of steam and smoke that hardly seems to be moving in the still air here over the swamp at Cape Kennedy. So with the American space shuttle so far safely launched on its maiden flight and on the 20th anniversary of man's first flight into space at that,
This is James Wilkinson at the Kennedy Space Centre handing you back to the studio in London.
Thank you very much indeed, James Wilkinson at Cape Canaveral, a very exciting event. And now with the time just after 3 minutes past one, with the rest of the news, we go to the Radio 2 newsroom and Gavin Campbell.
As work goes on to clear up the wreckage of last night's rioting in Brixton in South London, John Fraser, the Labour MP for the area, has called for a full inquiry into the trouble. He said the underlying problems in Brixton could no longer be brushed under the carpet. One black community leader has agreed with the Metropolitan Police Commissioner, Sir David McNee, that many of the young people involved in the clashes with the police came from outside the area. But another spokesman has rejected the police theory that the violence was pre-planned. According to New Scotland Yard, 106 arrests were made last night and 165 police officers were injured. Two policemen are said to be in a very serious condition, one with a fractured skull and the other with a stab wound in the back. Labour's deputy leader, Dennis Healey, has attacked authoritarian extremists in the party by calling them Margaret Thatcher's secret weapon. He told a meeting of the Labour Solidarity Campaign in Hastings that these extremists didn't worry that the British people would never vote for a party which held their views, nor did they care whether Labour won the next election. The Soviet conductor Maxim Shostakovich has asked for political asylum in West Germany for himself and his 19-year-old son. Police say he made the request after conducting a concert near Nuremberg with the Soviet Radio Symphony Orchestra. Both men are now under protection of the West German authorities. The conductor's father, Dmitry Shostakovich, who died 6 years ago, was the leading composer in the Soviet Union in the post-war period. People in many parts of Glasgow have been warned to boil domestic water before use. The authorities are taking this precaution following an overtime ban by water workers in the city. Tap water in some districts has become badly discoloured, and besides boiling it, householders are being asked to economise on use as much as possible. And now from our motoring unit, we have a warning for drivers in South London. After yesterday's disturbances in the Brixton area, there'll be a fairly large area that will be closed to through traffic throughout the day. It will extend from the Oval to Herne Hill, Denmark Hill and the Clapham Road. And that's the whole area around Brixton. Drivers are asked to avoid the area altogether. Well, that's all for the moment. Well, our next news is at 2 o'clock, but may we now advise VHF listeners in the Shetland Isles to retune to medium wave as your local transmitter is closing down at 2 o'clock until 5 o'clock this afternoon.
In the meantime, may I remind you, you're tuned to The Pete Murray Show. And we have a lovely song on the turntable by a talented lady named Lena Savarone.
Here I am, alone again. Not at all like I thought that I would be. Guess I lost my way. Seems like yesterday. Somebody promised me the sunshine. Somebody promised me the moon. Somebody told me there'd be roses and rainbows. I only hope they'll get here soon. Seems I've been waiting here forever, thinking that love would come for me. You are much too wise. If someone promised
Lena Zavaroni, Roses and Rainbows, that's her latest record. The time is now 11 and a half minutes past one, and very shortly, in fact, probably just after the record we're about to play for you, we'll be going back to James Wilkinson at Cape Canaveral. They just call them country songs, they forget the western part. It's Charlie Pride and Oklahoma Morning.
On an early autumn day, the freshness of the breeze brought the morning. And the sun come rising up, shining down on leaves that fell like golden snow. And the mystery of it all made the problems of the day seem unimportant. That Oklahoma morn, but Oklahoma sunshine in my soul. There ain't nothing like an Oklahoma morning. Nothing like it when you're feeling low. Sunshine in your soul. My campfire came to life, the crackling of the fire, the smell of coffee. Turn back the time to a day when a man could listen for a while to the sounds of Mother Nature without the sound of industry in the background. That Oklahoma morn, but Oklahoma sunshine in my smile. There ain't nothing like an Oklahoma.
They are extremely reliable. I suppose they're rather like giant fireworks. And there wasn't much doubt about them. They were much easier to develop. But it's unique among manned spacecraft in having a combination of liquid-fueled engines and solid-fueled engines at launch.
What about the technology in the flight deck? We look at the pictures that we've seen, and it's very much like an aeroplane, and they're using these cathode ray technology tubes to show them the instrumentation, aren't they?
That's right. It broadly looks like an aircraft flight deck, and they have about the same room in there. The whole shuttle orbiter itself is about the size of a DC-9 jet, or perhaps a Trident, the kind of thing that you go on your holidays on. It's meant, of course, to be flown back to its launch site, or its landing site, rather like an aircraft, although it doesn't have any engines like an aircraft does, so it's really better to think of it as a glider. And of course, the men on board are very experienced pilots, and they will need all their piloting skill when Columbia comes back to Earth, which is scheduled to do so in just over 2 days' time.
It's 15 minutes and 7 seconds after launch commit. Let's go back now to the Johnson Space Center in Houston. Andrew Manderstam is waiting for us there.
We had a slight moment of suspense earlier on, I think a misunderstanding with Mission Control, when we heard that they had lost communications with the spacecraft. In fact, they haven't. They've lost voice communications because of a routine switchover from one of the tracking stations on this side of the Atlantic to the Madrid tracking station. But throughout, they kept receiving signals from the geometry of the staff as they knew the ball was on board, and the loss of signal was in no way abnormal. The flight's going exceedingly well. The chart is now committed to orbit. There is no problem that so far we've been told about. We're just waiting to hear from NASA, who have promised us on the case of the report between the astronauts on board the Columbia and the Mission Control. The onboard OMS, which are the system which basically directs the craft in space, the OMS ignition occurred as normal. It was cut off also as normal 12 minutes after liftoff. Nothing really very dramatic happens now until the second burn of the OMS, which will occur in about 30 minutes from now. And of course, on the second orbit, they will do the first of the important tests. They will open the payload bay doors, which have to be opened to cool down the spacecraft.
Andrew Manistam in Houston. While he was talking, I think, Ian, something was happening.
That's right, yes. We've just heard that the maneuvering system burn was successful. They are now in the orbit that they expected to be in. The figures they give are 132 by 57 nautical miles. They still work in nautical miles, whatever that is in statute miles. But that's about the orbit that they were intending. So they are now safely in space, and we can all sit back and breathe.
17 minutes almost to the second after liftoff. Is that a typical orbit for the space shuttle?
Yes, this is what they were heading for, first of all. It's an elliptical orbit, as you'll see, 132 by 57 miles above the Earth. What they will do subsequently is to fire their manoeuvring system again, that is in about another 30 minutes or so, and that will circularise the orbit, and from then on they will be able to go into their procedure of opening the payload bay doors, which they have to do because on the inside of the payload bay doors there are radiators which dump the heat out into space like a normal radiator. And if those payload bay doors don't open, then they will have to come back to Earth on the fifth orbit. So although they are successfully in space, not all the problems are over yet, and the mission could still be still come back to Earth sooner than expected.
18 minutes mission elapsed time, about a minute away now from reacquiring Columbia through the Madrid tracking station. We'll stand by with the line open.
Does that mean they've lost communications at the moment until they pick it up with Madrid?
That's right. They hop from tracking station to tracking station, and when it's picked up by Madrid, we should start to hear the voices of the astronauts again, who I'm sure will be very happy men.
One thing that they must be finding a little bit different from previous space flights is the visibility. They have these enormous windows at the front, like an aircraft flight deck we were talking about earlier, not at all like those little portholes that we used to associate with Mercury, Gemini and Saturn.
That's right, and that is because of the different nature of the spacecraft itself. The fact that they have to see out of the window in order to be able to fly the thing properly, in order to get it back down onto the runway. The previous spacecraft used to just come zooming down into the atmosphere with the men lying on their backs looking upwards. They could actually see the parachutes above them that were helping to lower them safely to the ground. But they didn't see the ground. They didn't need to see the ground.
When the Space Flight Center at... They're coming up to Madrid. Now, does that mean they're over Spain?
Not...
Houston, talking to you through Madrid. Configure AOS. We have you for 4.5 minutes.
Okay, we're looking good. The stuff looks normal. The on-time battle is normal, and on-time their visual was about half.
Well, the important words there was looks nominal, which means that everything is going as it should do. They're not, doesn't mean they're directly over Spain, but they're within the visibility of the tracking station in Spain. They will be, the orbit does just about go over the southern part of Spain. There's no point dashing out to try and see them tonight because they won't be coming over Britain. But if they were, it would be bright enough to see, but it's just not coming that far north.
So, unfortunately, we won't be able to see it, but you will actually be able to see, if you're in the right place, something like, what, a shooting star?
Yes, it would look like a bright star or a bright satellite. The Skylab space station you could have seen until it re-entered 2 years ago. Russian space stations you can still see going overhead because they're in orbits which bring them over Britain.
20 minutes past 1 o'clock, 20 minutes after the launch of Columbia, and Andrew Manistam has been talking to the shuttle's team at Mission Control in Houston. He asked NASA spokesman Terry White just what is different about this project.
Well, the shuttle orbiter is sort of half airplane and half spacecraft. It comes back into the atmosphere and becomes essentially a big glider and coasts down to a landing on dry land instead of splashing down in the water as Apollo and Gemini and Mercury did before.
There have been a lot of difficulties in the project so far. It's running nearly 2.5 years behind schedule. Have those difficulties now been resolved satisfactorily?
Yeah, we're confident that all of the problems with the main engine and with the heat shield tile have been resolved, and we shouldn't have any further major delays because of technical difficulties. But getting back to this 2.5 years I keep hearing about, the delay, you got to remember that the initial estimate for first flight of being in 1978 was made 10 or 11 years ago. Before we ever cut metal to start building an orbiter, or before the design was even frozen. So I don't think we're doing bad as far as schedule.
It's been described as the most dangerous space mission yet, in the sense that the craft has never been tested in space conditions. Would that be an accurate description?
Yeah, I'd say so. This is the first time we've ever flown a new spacecraft manned on its first flight. and it'll be the first time we will have used solid rocket boosters in a manned flight. So to that extent, there is some risk.
NASA spokesman Terry White taking a look at the project before that 1 o'clock launch. What's the latest situation now, Ian?
The latest situation is that ground control is saying that they will be go for their second orbital manoeuvring system burn, which will circularise their orbit, but that won't be happening for about another 23, 24 minutes.
We pause now to go back to Houston. Waiting for us there, Andrew Mandelstam.
There's a tremendous feeling of relief here at Mission Control in Houston. I've seen the first of the proverbial cigars being lit up. As you know, the technicians and, of course, members of the press tend to come to these events with a cigar in their pocket, and when things go well, they light up the cigars, particularly at the end of the mission. It's slightly premature, perhaps, for the lighting cigar ceremony, but we do have the feeling here that everything has gone exceedingly well. The craft is now committed to one orbit. Of course, there still is a standby alert at the various fields around the world where the shuttle would have to land if it had to abort the mission at this stage, and they will remain on standby throughout the 54 and a half hours. It may not go to 54 and a half hours, because if there is the slightest fault of any sort, or if the crew gets tired, or for any other reason, NASA is quite happy to bring back the ship after about 24 hours, because about 90% of all that they want to accomplish on this, the first mission, will have been accomplished within the first 24 hours.
Andrew Mandelstam in Houston. Well, it's now 23 minutes almost to the second after the liftoff. We now have to wait until that orbital burn. What happens in the next couple of days?
In the next couple of days, the main thing that they will be doing later on today, about an hour and a half into the mission, which is, in other words, about 2:30 our time, they will do the critical opening of the payload bay doors. This is necessary to radiate away the waste heat.
Yeah.
But the main thing really is just to make sure that the thing flies. It's best to think of this as being like the first test flight of any new aircraft. You've got to make sure that it does what it's supposed to do. They don't have any payloads on board, but they've got a lot of monitoring equipment.
So when it comes back down again, we're going to be watching with just as much dramatic interest as we see the shuttle come in through the atmosphere.
In
what will we see?
In many ways, the most critical point of the mission is getting back in, because the thermal tile system, the heat shield system, has to work successfully, and that, of course, hasn't been successfully tested in space. The Columbia comes roaring into the atmosphere at about 10 times the speed of a supersonic Concorde, so they're moving extremely quickly. The whole part of that flight has to be guided by computers, because the men couldn't possibly make the decisions and react in time. But assuming it's through that highly critical time, then the astronauts will be able to take over and land it. So we won't be able to see very much of it during the critical re-entry period, but certainly through television cameras we will be able to see them making that final all-important manually controlled landing.
Let's look ahead to perhaps the shuttle in continuous use as what it's supposed to be, a space workhorse. What are the payloads it's going to be taking up? And especially let's look at this deep space satellite, because that's quite fascinating, isn't it?
It's going to be taking over the role of existing throwaway rockets, the kind of things that we've seen used so often before. Those rockets work very well, but they're expensive because they are destroyed during each mission. The shuttle's selling point, if you like, is the fact that it can come back to Earth, be refilled and go off again, so you don't have to build a new shuttle every time you want to launch something. Its payload bay is so large that it can actually take the size and weight of two fully loaded double-decker buses, which means it has a tremendous capacity. It can launch several satellites at once, which again helps to bring down costs. Communication satellites are important things that it will be launching. It will also be launching the Space Telescope later in the 1980s. That will be used by astronomers to help study the most remote parts of the universe. Also, Space Lab, the European-built space station. That will be an important payload during the 1980s, when men and women, scientists and engineers from the United States and Europe, will be able to work together in space, doing things like medical experiments, Earth survey experiments, the sort of things that will be of benefit to us all down here on Earth.
That space telescope, the Deep Space Telescope, will actually allow us to look very, very far back in time, won't it? Will it almost double the effective range that we will be able to look back into the universe?
More than that, you'll be able to see objects at least 100 times fainter. We could well be looking back to the time when the universe was very young, possibly even the origin of the universe, if it really did begin in a big bang, as astronomers think. The important point about going above the atmosphere is that the atmosphere acts as a blanket. It filters the radiation from space and it blurs it, because it's rather like a heat haze. The atmosphere is always moving. So astronomers will be able to see the sky much more clearly from up there in space, and they'll be able to study wavelengths such as X-rays, which don't get through the atmosphere. So it's a whole revolution in astronomy will be coming thanks to the shuttle.
27 minutes almost in elapsed time into the Columbia mission. Back now to Houston and Andrew Mandelstam.
Well, NASA has just been replaying on their closed-circuit television system a videotape of the launch, and you can see the relief and pride on the faces of the controllers here, because probably this is the first time they've actually been able to witness that launch. They were very much too busy at the time of the actual launch looking at their dials to really see what was happening. They're very relieved and very happy. The mission's still going exceedingly well. The craft now committed to its first orbit. As far as we can tell, as far as we're told at least, there have been no major snags at all at this stage.
Let's now talk, Ian, about the immediate future for Columbia and for the space shuttle. We've heard stories about people booking time on it and even possibly going up as passengers. Is that really likely?
There won't be room for paying passengers immediately, but certainly in the 1980s, when the Space Lab space station starts flying, there will be not just the two astronaut pilots who actually fly the craft, there will be room for four or perhaps five scientists and engineers on board who will be going along there to use the equipment that's actually on board to do experiments in space. So in that sense, there will be passengers on board, but I think it will be quite a while before Freddie Laker is flying flights into orbit.
Do you think that is ever likely?
I'm sure it is. People always said about aviation, oh, well, of course, it'll never really come to anything. But after a while, it's now quite natural. People don't think very much of leaping on an aeroplane and going off to Spain for their holidays. So possibly by the turn of the century, there may be orbital hotels. You could convert the cargo bay of the space shuttle to take fare-paying passengers. It'll be a change from the Seychelles for very rich people to boast about.
When it touches down in a couple of days' time, it lands, the landing time is expected to be about 54, 29 and 21 seconds. That's hours, minutes and seconds into the mission.
That's right.
And it won't be until quite some time afterwards. It takes about 2 minutes and a bit for it to come to the end of its, 2 mile landing run or so. And then it's going to be quite some time before they come out. The crew actually leaves Columbia. How do you think they're going to be feeling?
I would imagine that they will feel, they may have slightly queasy stomachs, because the thing certainly comes down extremely quickly. They will be relieved, because they will have gone through what many people have thought is the most risky manned space mission that has ever been undertaken.
That risky manned space mission that was ever undertaken started just about half an hour ago. Let's go back to that moment when Columbia lifted off at Cape Canaveral.
T-minus 27 seconds. We have gone for redundant set sequencer start. T-minus 20 seconds and counting. T-minus 15, 14, 13. T-minus 10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4. We've gone for main engine start. We have.
That's how it sounded just before 1 o'clock as Columbia lifted off. Andrew Mandelstam was at the Johnson Space Flight Center in Houston. My thanks to Ian Ridpath, our space correspondent here in the LBC Report studio. I'm Steve Wood.
Join Gavin Campbell at the Radio 2 news desk. America's space shuttle is now in orbit after successfully blasting off from Cape Canaveral. The launch, which came after a long series of delays and disappointments, went off without a hitch, and the astronauts have reported that everything is looking good. About 500,000 people turned out to watch the shuttle hurtle into space, and among them was our science correspondent, James Wilkinson.
Just an hour ago, the American space shuttle took off in an almost textbook launch. The launch took place exactly at 1 o'clock London time.
Mission Control has just announced that John Young, the commander of the shuttle, reported soon after launch that they were shaking around inside the shuttle. This could well be a slight pogo effect in one of the engines, which made the launch less than smooth. But apart from that, the solid rockets fell away exactly as they were intended to do and are now floating in the Atlantic Ocean. The external fuel tank fell in the Indian Ocean just 10 miles from where it was predicted it would fall. So far, then, everything is going well.
Space Shuttle, the first spaceship designed to be able to fly back to Earth and land like an aeroplane, has just completed 2 hours of its first mission, and everything seems to be going well. The rescheduled launch took place exactly on time today from Cape Canaveral in view of a huge crowd as well as millions of television viewers. As the space vehicle slowly lifted from the ground, one of the two pilots, Bob Crippen, exclaimed, "What a feeling, what a view." But the veteran John Young was more laconic. The shuttle has now successfully gone into orbit around the Earth and should complete 36 circuits before landing on the dry bed of a lake in California on Tuesday evening. Just before blast-off, the American president, Ronald Reagan, told the astronauts, "You carry the hopes and prayers of all Americans."
The label... A few heat-resistant tiles have been found missing from the rear of the vehicle. Officials say they're not vital, and they won't represent a hazard to the crew on re-entry. Independent Radio News, it's 3 minutes past 3.
Have begun important computer operations and have been preparing to open the ship's payload bay doors, which will be vital if the craft is to be cleared for the full 2.25-day mission. Doctors say that John Young's heartbeat was only about 85 to 90 a minute during takeoff, whereas Bob Crippen's, who was making his first space flight, had a heart rate of 130 beats a minute. The opposition...
Home Secretary Willie Whitelaw has been in the American Space Shuttle Columbia have been given the go-ahead to proceed with the full 36-orbit mission. A fault with the heat-resistant tiling had been noticed on the second orbit. Andrew Manderstam reports.
NASA officials are insisting that the fact that at least three of the heat-resistant tiles have fallen off will not lead to a shortening of the mission, nor will it necessitate an inspection of the damage by the astronauts who could embark on a spacewalk should it be required. Here at Mission Control in Houston, I asked future shuttle astronaut Jeff Hoffman how serious the problem was.
From everything that we see so far, there is nothing to be concerned about at all, because the tiles which we've been able to see missing are not at all critical for re-entry.
The missing tiles are all situated in the upper part of the craft. The question now is whether other tiles have fallen off on the underside of the shuttle, the part that forms the vital re-entry heat shield. Photographs have been taken by powerful cameras on the ground in an attempt to discover whether the shield has been damaged. Andrew Manderstam, IRN, at Mission Control, Houston.
As moves get underway, they've given the Space Shuttle astronauts the go-ahead to complete the full 36-orbit mission, in spite of an examination of the Columbia craft which showed some of the heat-resistant tiles are missing. Here's Andrew Manderstam at Mission Control Center in Houston.
NASA officials are by and large well pleased with the flight so far. They've given astronauts John Young and Bob Crippen the go-ahead to complete the full 54.5-hour mission. The one problem that has emerged, the heat-resistant tiles which have fallen off from the upper part of the craft, is not considered serious. I asked Jerry Wheeler, a spokesman for Rockwell International, the company which produced the tiles, whether he was worried.
No, I'm not particularly worried. I've got a lot of confidence in this system. It's probably been given more attention than any other system that we have, and we've done a lot of work on it. If there were to be any tiles fall off, I think we would have expected to find them right where we did. And other than that, I really don't think we're going to have any more tiles that are, you know, lost.
There's no evidence that any of the tiles which form part of the vital heat shield which protect the craft during re-entry have been damaged. Andrew Manderstam, IRN, at Mission Control, Houston.
The Actors Union
Mission Control in Houston.
NASA officials say that the flight so far has exceeded their expectations. The one problem which has arisen, the loss of at least 15 out of the 32,000 tiles which help insulate the craft from the intense heat generated during re-entry, is not considered serious. I asked a future shuttle astronaut, Jeff Hoffman, what his feelings would be if he was piloting the craft, bearing in mind the missing tiles.
It's in the nature of the business that if you can't do something about a situation, you don't worry about it. I'm sure that's what Young and Crippen are feeling now. They have every confidence that the tiles are intact. There's nothing that they can do about it, and so they'll press on and successfully complete the mission.
The space shuttle, which took off like a rocket, is due to land like a plane at Edwards Air Force Base in California tomorrow evening. Andrew Manderstam, IRN at Mission Control, Houston.
It is now well into its 54-hour mission. In a perfect launch, it blasted off from Cape Canaveral at about 1 o'clock our time yesterday. The two astronauts on board, the veteran John Young and Robert Crippen, have been sleeping for the past few hours. When they're woken up in just over an hour's time, they'll be making further tests on Columbia's systems. There were only one or two minor problems on the first day, but they shouldn't affect tomorrow's landing on a special runway at the Edwards Air Force Base in California. It's from there that Paul Reynolds reports.
Both Mission Control and the astronauts were delighted with day one. The man who expressed this excitement most was the younger of the two astronauts, Robert Crippen. It's his first journey into space, and in a televised progress report, he was enthusiastic.
The spacecraft has worked as advertised all the way along. A few little minor news problems, but nothing of significance. I guess the major one you guys are working on down there is dealing with some of our instrumentation. I think we've got something that's really going to mean something to the country and the world.
At the end of their first working day, 13 hours in space, Crippen and Young had completed their tests more or less on time, and only two problems were apparent. A flight recorder refused to turn itself off as required, and more seriously, about 15 insulation towels on the engine pods at the rear had come off during the launch. This is not a critical area on re-entry, so flight controllers are not worried, nor are the astronauts. Nevertheless, checks are being made with powerful cameras on the ground to see if there's any tile damage in other more sensitive areas of the spaceship. The results of these checks are not yet in. As the astronauts prepare to buckle themselves into their seats for the night, with eye masks and earplugs to help them relax, Mission Control thanked them for a hard day's work.
It's sure been fun working with you today, and we look forward to seeing you in the morning. I hope you get a good night's rest. We've got about 20 seconds to go.
Okay, it's been fun working with the bronze team. You guys did super work today. See you mañana.
Today, their program includes further tests on the shuttle systems and a 25-minute television show from the cockpit.
The main British banks have launched a protest against the special one-off tax on their profits announced in the budget. The banks, who've written to all MPs, are hoping to get support during the second reading of the...
Our correspondent Bob Friend reports from Okinawa.
The American colonel with the droll sense of humour pointed to a shakily drawn picture of the shuttle and explained the landing procedure to the audience of visiting journalists. The shuttle, he said, is designed to glide in gently, like a brick. His briefing was punctuated with not sures and don't knows, and he admitted that the rescue recovery squad, motto that others might live, had received only 10 hours training from NASA experts who visited the base in December. Normally, the rescue squad are used for aeroplane emergencies. They all seemed confident that a space shuttle wouldn't overtax their ingenuity. Okinawa has a history of protests at the substantial military presence here. The local newspaper insisted today that the use of Okinawa as an emergency landing ground for the shuttle should be reviewed once it was used for military purposes. Japan, it said, should have no part in the military space race between Russia and America. If a space shuttle did land at Kadena, it would be here for 3 months. 200 technicians would fly in from America, and a giant ramp would have to be built to load the spacecraft onto the jumbo jet, which would take it home. For a number of reasons, said an Air Force spokesman, we are hoping it reaches its scheduled destination.
Bob Friend in Okinawa.
I think there's no difference in principle. Look like this. No, we are going up to the sky, and it's not space directly. It's only a little bit more than sky, and we are flying today in 8 or 10 miles or 50 miles, and then we have 300 miles. That's all, and we are going not only on an airline, on a ship line on the ground, but also in a space lab above. We'll have big stations, and in these stations you can live, you can have manufacturing, you can have experience, and also you can book a flight as business as usual. That's a space line with access to everybody in the future.
Mr. Norman, you make it sound as though you're setting up some kind of package tour industry.
Why not? Even today exists a calculator of the space line, and you have the rates and the charges for space, and you can order this in the same way as if you are going to another carrier.
So when will we be able to book a flight in the shuttle?
If you are interested as a journalist, you can write in the early 80s or in the late 80s, but I think in 1990, in the 19s, there will be access nearly to everybody, and we'll have 10,000 of people in space.
But the big snag must be the cost. I mean, surely it's going to be expensive.
The cost is not so very expensive, as we have a reusable system. Look, the payload of the orbiter is 23 tons, but if you have passengers, usual passenger equipment, you can have 200 or 300 passengers.
Well, from the rough figures you gave me earlier, I mean, the charter of the shuttle is going to cost about £4 million a trip. That's about £13,000 a head. I mean, would you be prepared to pay that sort of money for a flight?
Why not?
Back on Nordman. Well, this should be all right. Airline food is already well adapted to being sucked up through plastic tubes out of a weightless globule. It's 19 minutes to 8. Here's Pauline Bushnell.
And the American space shuttle are asleep, but they will wake up in about 2 hours' time and prepare for their return to Earth. The shuttle will land this evening on a dry lake bed at the Edwards Air Base in California. Reporting from the base, our science correspondent, James Wilkinson, says the mission has gone well, apart from a few small problems with equipment.
One of the pieces of equipment not working is a recording machine, which they hoped would record the temperature of the shuttle during re-entry. But the switch on the machine has gone wrong. One possible way for the machine to be made to work would be for astronaut Bob Crippen to get out of his seat to operate the switch after the re-entry engines have been fired to slow the shuttle down, but before it re-enters the atmosphere. A decision on whether he should do that will be taken soon. NASA is now confident the tiles won't cause problems on re-entry. They won't say why they're so sure, but it's likely the underside of the shuttle has been photographed by a satellite belonging to the Department of Defense. The shuttle will re-enter the atmosphere somewhere over the Indian Ocean and then glide in towards a dry lake bed here at Edwards Air Force Base, landing at just over 200 miles an hour.
The leader of the Polish...
And that's a reminder of home that the astronauts in the space shuttle got as a change from all those technical conversations they've been having about loose tiles. It went on to play a boogie-woogie bugler boy from Company B, played by a group of flight controllers from the Johnson Space Center who've adopted the name Contraband, which presumably has less to do with smuggling than with being against other bands. James Wilkinson, our science correspondent, has been in the midst of all these astral arpeggios. He's on the line now from the landing site at Edwards Air Force Base, California. James, where precisely are you speaking from?
Well, I'm speaking to you now from just beside the landing strip on the dry lake bed itself. It's quite an extraordinary place, really. There's nothing here except a few hardy photographers who set up their equipment waiting for the shuttle to come in. Apart from that, there's nothing for miles around except a few rattlesnakes.
And what's the latest news on the shuttle itself? Is all going well?
Well, everything is going well, yes. The astronauts are in bed asleep at the moment. Not in bed, should I say. They are asleep anyway. They will be waking up in a few hours' time and prepare for the landing.
And are there any fears about these missing tiles we've heard so much about, or are they reasonably happy about that?
Well, NASA does seem to be very confident about the tiles. They've been a bit secretive about why they're so confident. The press has been pressing them to find out what's wrong, how they're so confident. But I think the likely explanation is that they have been photographed by one of the military satellites, one of the Defense Department satellites, and I think that those photographs must have shown that the tiles underneath the shuttle are in a good order.
Well, we'll hope that all goes well for this evening. We shall be hearing from you then, James. Thank you very much.
The Space Shuttle Columbia is due to land at 7:22 p.m. tonight, just about 4 minutes ahead of schedule. But first, the craft has to go through the rigors of its first ever re-entry into the atmosphere. This is the most crucial stage of the entire mission, especially in view of the uncertainty concerning the vital heat-insulating tiles, some of which are known to have fallen off or have been damaged. For the return to be successfully completed, the pitch of the craft has to be correct, and the rocket, which slowed down the shuttle, must function normally. NASA officials are well pleased with the way the craft is performing so far. The astronauts have had a last-minute snack before returning, consisting of tuna fish and macaroni and cheese. If all goes well, the shuttle will enter the atmosphere 3,400 miles from their landing site, flying at about six times the speed of sound. Andrew Mandelstam, IRN, at Mission Control, Houston.
The trial of Bradford... And it's sufficient to keep that table of, you know, of sand absolutely level. And this is why the astronauts and the pilots before them have chosen to land there. It really is a marvellous environment.
Do they actually have a runway, or is it so flat they don't need one?
No, they do have runways marked out, and the space shuttle itself will be landing on a marked runway. The nice thing about it is that the runway is identical to the rest of the surface around. There's no sort of nasty breaks or curb stones or anything like that. It's just completely smooth.
Mm. Where are they at the moment, the astronauts, in terms of the Earth's surface?
Right now they're coming in over the Pacific. They've got a most beautiful view. They have now changed their attitude so that they're looking up into space, but they can see through their instrumentation their attitude, and they will be coming down from the Pacific towards the American coastline.
And when they actually blast the out of orbit, they're what, over the Indian Ocean, am I right?
Yeah, the actual deorbit manoeuvre, I'm just checking on the times over here, if it occurs at 6:21, then they'd be
firing just over the Indian Ocean in order to maintain the proper profile.
Mm. Now, Edwards Air Force Base itself, does it have a history? One always connects it with astronauts' ambitions and so on, but was it set up for that purpose?
No, the original base was set up back in the late 20s as an Army Air Corps base for pilots to test aircraft over there and to learn how to fly aeroplanes. And during the war, it was used for training a lot of pilots and aircrew for the Second World War. But it really had interesting origins back in 1910, when it started off as a post office.
A what?
A post office. The lady who, in fact, gave her name to the original area was a lady called Effie Corum, and she wanted to open a post office up in the desert. Why, I don't know. And applying for the name, it was turned down. So she had to turn the name round, and it was therefore called Muroc Post Office, and that's why it was then called Muroc Air Force Base and Muroc Dry Lake Bed.
How extraordinary. And am I right that the $6 million man originated in Edwards Air Force Base?
Yes, it did. The man, in fact, is based on a real pilot who was flying one of the vehicles that was used in the original design conception of the Space Shuttle landing today. And this unfortunate gentleman, who marvelously is alive and well and flying over at Edwards Air Force Base even now, he came in on this lifting body, which then went into a very dangerous attitude and eventually crashed on the base. And the film of that inspired the original writer to create a film about a pilot who survived such an incident and was reconstructed.
How extraordinary. Well, the other set of eyes and ears belong to Paul Reynolds. He is actually at Edwards Air Force Base. We'll have some music, then we'll see if we can contact him. We're not having too much luck so far, as a matter of fact, but...
Shuttle has come through intact, although that would not tell us whether the crew are well.
So, indeed, there will be absolutely no contact. I know they've been monitoring pulse rates, monitoring even when the astronauts are asleep. But that's all, I suppose, done by radio, so they won't even know pulse rates or anything like that to see if they're alive or not.
No information whatsoever at that stage until the radio waves can come through yet again. This is, as I said, something which happens with all space flights when they re-enter into the atmosphere. It's in no way unusual, but of course it's particularly tense because remember that this craft has never been tested under space conditions. With previous missions, such as the Apollos and the Mercurys, NASA sent up a similar craft to orbit the Earth without any men on board. They were not able to do this with a shuttle because of budgetary restraints and because they say that they had full confidence in the craft anyway. So this is totally new terrain.
And also, are they expecting an increased friction? Because I imagine previous ones are sort of more rocket-shaped. This has got wings and things, so it can land on its own.
Largest craft, manned craft, ever to attempt to re-enter the Earth's atmosphere. And added to that, of course, is the question mark which is hanging over the entire mission, and that's those heat-resistant tiles. We know that 15 tiles or so have either dropped off or have been damaged on the upper section of the craft, a part of the craft which is not vital. Nonetheless, we aren't absolutely certain that no other tiles have not been affected in the underbelly part of the craft which doubles out of a heat shield on re-entry. If vast expanses of tiles are missing in that area, then the prospects are very bleak indeed. But we have some indication through the temperature on board the craft, through various photographs that have been taken on the ground, that nothing has gone amiss in that vital zone. But we can't be absolutely certain, and that's why the situation here remains very tense, everybody keeping their fingers crossed.
And on to more mundane matters. At Edwards Air Force Base, I believe there are several thousand people gathered to watch it.
Well, it's in the middle of a desert, and we're seeing pictures of gigantic traffic jams, traffic stretching back 6 miles from the entrance of Edwards Air Force Base. A lot of people, about 100,000 in all apparently, want to see the shuttle return. They won't see very much because the first contact they'll get from the ground will be about 1 minute before touchdown. Once the craft is actually on that enormous runway, it's nearly 6 miles long and it's 300 feet wide, they'll see even less because the astronauts will remain on board the shuttle for at least 40 minutes for debriefing to check out the equipment, and in case there may be any hazardous gases on board the craft or radiation or other hazards, that's all going to be checked out before the astronauts come out. Then they'll come out onto the runway and we're told make a short statement which we will be able to hear.
And of course this will be actually heard and seen right around the globe. I take it just about every country on Earth will be monitoring this.
Yes, NASA has set up what's called a pool television facility. Those are NASA cameras which will beam back radio and television programming of the return of the shuttle and, of course, of that statement which will be made. We hope, we're not promised that, but we hope the statement which will be made on the return of the astronauts. And then the day for the astronauts is not finished by any means because after that they will take part in another flight, this time a subsonic flight, across part of the United States back to their home base here in Houston. where they're due to arrive shortly after midnight, London time, tomorrow morning.
Andrew, thank you very much. We'll be getting back to you very, very shortly, of course, for when they fire, I've forgotten what you call them, but the retro rockets to the uninitiated. It's 14 and a half minutes past six.
Rates, inflation, and now a horrifying rent review increase. Is there no way...
Astronauts are about to fire rockets aboard the Space Shuttle Columbia, which will turn it round, slow it down, and prepare it for the hour-long descent to ground.
Procedure has to be gone through to get them out safely. So teams will go in, equipped, if necessary, with wind machines to disperse toxic gases. Firemen will be standing by. The first person on board will be the doctor, Dr. Fisher, who's the astronaut's chief doctor. We spoke to him this morning as he was getting some breakfast, and he said everything had gone absolutely marvellously. There'd been no physical problems at all, and he said everyone was absolutely thrilled with the whole flight so far.
Good. All right, Paul, we'll be back with you very shortly. To music now, and this is...
...told us that those tiles which were last guy off the shuttle are not dangerous, but they haven't told us how they know. Would you like to speculate on that?
Yes, of course it has to be speculation, but I think it's a fairly reasonable supposition that what they've been doing is taking photographs from ground-based cameras, which would be essentially based at places like Kwajalein out in the Pacific, where they photograph the Russian reconnaissance satellites and... Russian satellites. So they are probably pointing their cameras up at their own shuttle and taking pictures of their own shuttle. Now the resolution of those cameras must obviously be sufficient for them to have confidence. And so I would assume that they've got a resolution of, let's say, 6 inches at a distance of 100 miles.
Heaven's sake! So they're taking those pictures all the time of, I suppose, Russian satellites as well?
Yes, they can track every single object in space using the NORAD facility in Cheyenne Mountain, which is buried underneath the mountain, and they can pick up needles, for example. If you were to put up a pin in space, that could be measured using their over-the-horizon radar systems. So they really do monitor everything, and they have zoom television cameras so that they can watch the satellites actually in space. Of course, this is for those in a lower orbit.
But you could actually see the astronauts through the windows from the ground with these cameras.
I believe so. Nobody will actually sort of confirm that officially, but I think you can rest assured that they can see the tiles, and therefore they can see if a tile is missing. Their problem, of course, is the tiles are black, and that's why they're manoeuvring the shuttle orbiter, or they have been previously, in order to get the angle of sunlight and reflection from the Earth.
Mm. Well, the time is just past 21 minutes past six. I don't know if Paul Reynolds has had any news yet about this blast out of orbit. Paul, are you with us still?
Yes, John. No, we've received no news about the de-orbit ignition. This is largely because the astronauts are out of contact with ground stations at the moment. We don't expect to pick them up until they come over Australia at 35 minutes past the hour. We then expect to get a report on the deorbit ignition. Can I just add one thing about this? It's quite an interesting configuration of the spacecraft. It's flying backwards upside down when it fires its orbital engines. And that has the effect, of course, as it's flying backwards, of slowing it down. And then it'll begin this process of re-entering the Earth's atmosphere. Before it does that, it has to bring itself up into a nose-forward position. So they translate the spacecraft into an angle of 40 degrees nose-forward, which means that it's going sort of belly-first with the nose up. And that's why the underneath gets most of the heat.
Sure. So you won't actually know about that burn until about 25 minutes to 7 hour time?
That is my understanding from Mission Control, who said they would be reporting on that deorbit burn at 35 minutes past the hour when they came to one of the two Australian tracking stations. They may have some computer information before that, though.
Yeah. Okay, Paul, we'll be in touch very shortly, I hope. Thanks a lot. But just coming back, Guy, to this business of these cameras in space. Now, you take a picture of the shuttle.
Well, the official NASA release organization has given us confirmation of that particular maneuver. The craft at the moment is flying... here we have tap confirmation.
Here in the control center, the clock that had been counting down toward the orbit ignition has been reestablished as a touchdown clock, now reading 58 minutes, 16 seconds to touchdown at Edwards.
Yargety contact, this is Houston contact, testing one.
Well, that's, of course, got nothing to do with the burn, but purely a question of logistics. They're testing their equipment, realigning their clocks for re-entry, and still no word as to whether those rockets did burn properly. We're actually in a phase where we have no direct contact with the craft. This is because we're waiting for reacquisition of signal from one of the tracking stations. As the craft goes around in its orbit. It's handed on from one listening post to another, and there are gaps in the system, very much like an ordinary aircraft when it's on a particular airline, also gets handed over from one particular controller to another. And we're now in one of those intermediary stages where there is no direct contact with the craft, and so we have to wait for the acquisition of the signal from the next relay station on the line to be able to tell whether or not the engines did function normally. We have nonetheless no indications which would suppose otherwise, and as far as we can tell, the engine did activate a little bit ahead of schedule and operated correctly. As soon as we have confirmation, I'll come back to you.
Andrew, thank you very much. Andrew Manistam at Mission Control in Houston. With me in the studio is our space expert Ian Ridpath again. Ian, this firing these rockets 4 minutes early, to a layman that means, you know, that's going to push it into the Earth's atmosphere 4 minutes early, so it'll land in the middle of Africa instead of California, right or wrong?
No, they're doing it for a specific reason, that the orbit that the Columbia spaceship is in is just a little bit lower than they had originally intended. It's only a matter of a couple of miles. There's nothing dangerous or untoward about that. All orbits are usually a few miles off. You aim for one, you get as close to it as you can. You expect to be a couple of miles out. So they're just a little bit closer to the Earth than was originally expected. So all the orbit ignition burns and the landing come a few minutes earlier. There's nothing untoward about that. The noise, the sounds in the background we heard a couple of minutes ago were attempting to establish contact with the tracking station at Yargadee, which is in Australia. And it's in about the next minute from now that they are anticipating to pick up communications from Columbia, which will tell us whether or not that deorbit burn was successful. It should have lasted about 2 minutes and 40 seconds. It slows the spacecraft down by about 200 miles an hour. The spacecraft itself is actually going at about 17,000 miles an hour relative to the Earth, but just by slowing it that little amount, that enables gravity to pull the spacecraft back to Earth, and we certainly hope we will be seeing it on the ground about an hour from now.
And they monitor it purely without the astronauts. They don't need the astronauts to say, we're okay, it's going fine.
Well, the astronauts on board will know whether or not their firing has been successful, because the onboard instruments will tell them. The orbital maneuvering system engines they're using, these are small engines which were initially used to push them up into orbit after the external tank had been jettisoned at launch 2 days ago. These are the biggest rockets that they've now got on board. They just give a little extra push and can help.
Isn't it odd the way some airlines are...
It's a little slower than 17,000 miles an hour. We check London's roads. I believe they have re-established contact with the Space Shuttle Columbia. It's back to Andrew Manistam at Mission Control in Houston. Andrew, what's happened?
Yes, much relief here. We've heard in the last few seconds from the spacecraft, which was out of contact due to a handover in radio communications, that the two rockets which will place the craft back onto Earth, back into the correct trajectory. Let's go to Mission Control.
Time to have two of the three APUs running. The third APU is powered up at entry interface minus 5 minutes. We're now at entry interface minus 19 minutes, 22 seconds.
Yes, that means we have two out of the three engines running, and that is what is scheduled at this particular point of the mission. So everything so far going well for re-entry.
Andrew, thank you very much. Andrew Manistam at Mission Control in Houston. It's 6:30. Andrew, we should now have details of whether the rocket firing was successful or not.
Yes, two things have happened in the past few minutes. First, we've had confirmation that the re-entry burn was successful, therefore the craft is now directing itself for a re-entry. And the second piece of information we have is that the craft is now committed to landing on this orbit. It means that there's no turning back. It has to re-enter the Earth's atmosphere at this stage. It's also a very crucial, critical time, because it's a time when the heat on board, on the exterior of the craft, is beginning to build up. And of course, there's been a lot of concern over the state of those heat-resistant tiles which protect the craft from the intense heat generated during re-entry into the atmosphere. We know that 15 or so of the tiles have either been damaged or fallen off. We believe that there's no damage to the vital underbelly part of the craft, which doubles up as a heat shield. But there's no way of telling at this particular stage. So everybody here keeping their fingers crossed. But so far, the re-entry phase operating normally, all systems are go on board.
Okay, and this is Ian Ridpath in LBC's Space Studio. As we've heard, preparations for Columbia's re-entry are going well. They're now over the Indian Ocean, approaching the northwestern coast of Australia. Just after 6:30, four chase planes took off from Edwards Air Force Base, and astronaut John Young said we'll be there in about 35 minutes. And the astronauts on board are in very good humour. Bob Crippen, on his first space flight, quoted, "Whoever said that space is black wasn't kidding. It really is black," he said, and termed it my great scientific observation. "You're bragging," said ground control. "No, you've never heard a Texan do that," replied Crippen. So they're in good humour, and everybody's looking forward to a very successful touchdown.
I'm a bit cynical about that. I think it's sort of like, I'm in good humour, because they must be terrified at 17,000 miles an hour. I don't get what anybody says. 21 minutes to 7 the time now. The newly installed MP for Fermanagh and South Tyrone.
Station is one of smoothness in terms of transition, that is, of actual movement of your body. But it's a smooth violence, in a sense, in the attitude that you have to take with your mind, because you're rolling that machine the lower you go in order to burn off energy. The unique characteristic of this aircraft, spacecraft, is that it rolls its way through the atmosphere in the last phases. And that's the place where I'd love to put a film camera.
But they don't actually feel as if they're in the atmosphere, apart from the fact they've got their weight back. It doesn't sort of bump like an aircraft in bad weather conditions or
not something like that. Not necessarily at high altitude, because the air is so thin. But certainly it'll start getting bumpy the lower down they go. And by the time they're going through, let's say, 90,000 feet, which is about 5 miles higher than Concorde flies, Then they're feeling those aerodynamic pressures very strongly.
But by that time, they are an aircraft.
They are definitely an aircraft, relying entirely on their skill.
Well, the next thing we're actually waiting for is what's called the re-entry interface in this marvellous American jargon, which is due to take place about 6:50, which is just before we go into this period of communications blackout.
Yeah.
What exactly is happening then?
Well, the re-entry interface, it is critical to get the angle of attack, that is, the nose-up angle of the machine, in the correct position, and to have achieved a certain height, a certain velocity, and therefore a certain amount of energy, which, as well as a geographical position relative to the base.
Mm.
So that is very important, and that's what they're aiming for.
Can I play you a tune? From Edwards Air Force Base, that the shuttle looks as if it's been slightly longer coming down than they'd anticipated, because the communications blackout is not expected now until around about 6:56, about 5 minutes later. Does that strike terror to your heart, Guy?
No, I think the situation is that the atmosphere itself, when it's heated up underneath the spacecraft, ionizes it, and therefore it changes its state. And radio waves can't propagate through that ionized layer.
But the fact that it's later than we'd anticipated, does that suggest anything to you?
No, I don't think so, because it's very difficult to predict exactly what the atmosphere is going to do, as everybody involved, you know, in radio has to suffer. Yeah. That the atmosphere changes, and so I would say that this blackout is entirely an atmospheric phenomenon.
Do they rely entirely on their engines at this stage for the braking effect that they're getting?
Yes. For this deorbit manoeuvre, they have two engines which are mounted on the fin itself, in fact, at the base of the fin, and it's that where those 14 towers were missing over the fairing for those two engines. And these two engines give a thrust of about 6,000 pounds, that's about, 3 tons of thrust each. But they're very, very important, because they have to slow the whole aircraft down.
Mm. Right, back shortly. The time now is 6:45. That's our regular time for going to the sports deck.
Phases of the whole Space Shuttle Columbia operation is underway, or should have just gone underway. We cross again to Mission Control in Houston. The re-entry phase, Andrew, is it going okay?
Yes, in fact, in about 40 seconds from now, the craft should have re-entered the atmosphere. We're now in what's called the communications blackout. This is totally normal in any space flight. It's a time when, due to various physical conditions, one is unable to have radio communications with a spacecraft as it re-enters the Earth's atmosphere. The blackout period will last about 16 minutes in all, and we hope that after that we will have a reacquisition of the signal. At the moment, though, everything appears to be going very well. A series of experiments are going to be taking place during the blackout, or just as the craft enters into the atmosphere. The Space Shuttle Orbiter Columbia is going to be photographed by a special craft which has a very sensitive telescope on board. This is to test out the actual heat on the exterior of the craft, and of course it's that heat which is absolutely vital in view of the problems we've had with the heat-resistant tiles. But so far, everything going well at the re-entry stage, although we have no radio communications and won't have for a few more minutes.
So indeed, as they have been monitoring while the craft is way out in space, they will still be able to see whether it's in one piece or not, even though they don't have radio contact.
Yes, that's right. The high-flying aircraft carries this 36-inch telescope. It's used by astronomers, and they will be taking this heat picture, as Andrew said. They will be able to tell afterwards if the heating was as expected. We're just getting a message through from shuttle control. They are now out of contact with the shuttle. They will not be back in contact with it until about 7 or 8 minutes past 7 o'clock this evening, when the astronauts will be through the most dangerous part of the mission. Just a couple of minutes ago, they entered the Earth's atmosphere as defined by NASA. That's at a height of about 75 miles or 400,000 feet. And the next time we see them, they'll be moving at about 12 times the speed of sound. They'll still be going pretty quickly.
Ian, surely if they can actually see the thing in telescope form, mm-hmm. they can actually see whether it's overheated or not. A metal changes colour when it's over hot, surely.
That's right. They're making infrared heat measurements. They'll know what the temperature is, but of course that'll be no use to the astronauts if the temperature is too high. They're committed to re-entry. Only the astronauts will know for about the next 15 minutes whether or not that heat shield system has stood up to the heat of re-entry. We won't know until signal is reacquired at about 7 or 8 minutes past 7 by the ground tracking stations. Although, of course, as I say, if it does actually break up, then the tracking telescopes will see the bits, although I've no real fear that that will actually happen.
And if it was actually some of those heat shields faulty, that doesn't mean that the astronauts are in problems. I mean, they might feel a bit uncomfortable, but they could still survive that.
Oh, that's right. If there are a few missing. Now, the bits that they have seen that are missing are on the back top surface of the shuttle. They are not actually the silica tiles, which are designed to stand the highest temperatures of all. They're actually made out of a substance known as Nomex felt, N-O-M-E-X, and that's actually a heat-resistant nylon. As the NASA controller said yesterday, that the worst that could happen was that part of the shuttle's metal skin might buckle and have to be replaced. But of course, that in itself is something of an admission of failure, because the whole point about the shuttle is that you're not supposed to need to do very much maintenance on it. You're supposed to be able to turn it round and fly it again.
Well, we'll cross back to Mission Control once again. Andrew, this deathly silence must be absolutely killing them there, but I suppose they're trained for it. So is it relatively calm, or is there a big amount of tension at the moment? Andrew Mandelstam at Mission Control in Houston. Well, we've got Mission Control all right, but we've lost Andrew Mandelstam. Yes. That, I suppose, is the most minor detail of all in this fairly dramatic turn of events. Ian, this thing actually running down from 17,000 miles an hour.
17,000 miles an hour.
And it's only 75 miles above the Earth, right? Roundabout.
It is now about 75 miles above the Earth. It was originally 175 miles above the Earth. It comes in at a tremendous descent rate, about 10,000 feet per minute, which is considerably greater than the descent rate of any aircraft. I mean, if you lose your stomach in a high-speed lift, you certainly wouldn't want to travel in the space shuttle. But as soon as they fired those engines, they were committed to landing at a precise spot at Edwards Air Force Base, several thousand miles away. So the navigation of this whole thing has to be absolutely precise and pinpoint. It's an extraordinary piece of technology.
But to be reasonable about the landing, I take it that in the end it lands at really not that much faster than a jumbo jet.
The speed at which the shuttle should touch down, if everything goes correctly, is just about 200 miles an hour. That's about 50% faster than a traditional jet aircraft. Of course, if anything goes wrong, they may come a little short or overrun a bit, but there's plenty of room at Edwards Air Force Base for them to miss. That's the whole point of landing there. They are trying to aim on this 15,000-foot long runway, but if they miss it, there's plenty of room either way, lots of desert for them to land on.
And very briefly, I think we have Andrew Mandelstam at Mission Control once again. Andrew, I guess the tension is building up there right now.
Well, we're still waiting for acquisition of the signal, which will occur in about, we're told, let me see, it should be another 10 minutes or so. At that time, the craft will be at an altitude of 170,000 feet, that's 490 miles, to touch down at Edwards Air Force Base. And I can assure you that everyone here will be much relieved once they hear those strains from both astronauts on board the Columbia. It is a very nerve-testing time because not only have we lost voice contact with them, but also all the telemetry, which we had during most of the flight, which allowed us to gauge their heartbeat, their general condition, the condition of the craft itself. All that is not possible, all that is not available to the ground controllers. The first indication that they will have that all has gone to plan will probably be a radar contact, a contact with the craft, which will show that the craft is intact, but it won't give you any idea as to whether the men inside are alive and well.
Andrew, if something does go wrong, and then, I mean, this is getting macabre, and they're not actually dead, but they are incapable or incapacitated, can they actually control that craft from the ground to make it land safely, or is it totally on the astronauts?
No, the craft is totally controlled by onboard computers, which are linked into computers here at Mission Control in Houston. It is possible to bring the craft down in what they call a crash mode if the astronauts on board are not conscious. The plan, though, at the moment is for the commander of the craft, for John Young, to take over manual control after the last 50,000 feet of the descent into Edwards Air Force Base. There are all sorts of contingency plans which are available to the astronauts if there is a problem, provided that they have survived re-entry. They can, once the craft has reached 100,000 feet, actually bail out of the plane using ejector seats and landing probably in the water by parachute. Or there is another contingency plan for them to crash land the craft into the sea if it can't quite make the California coastline. But then, as one NASA official put it to me, unfortunately, we've lost the craft, and that was the whole point of the exercise, because it's supposed to be a reusable craft. But at least, and more important of the two, the astronauts should be able to get out alive.
Andrew, thank you very much. We'll have to leave it there. We're coming up to our news time. We'll get back to you very, very shortly.
Isn't it odd the way some airlines are rushing to introduce
got communications back with them? So at this altitude, the safest thing they can do is to stay with that vehicle.
Just to go on a little bit more about why we've lost contact with them. You were talking earlier about the ionization that builds up on the underside of the shuttle.
Yes. This is really quite simply the fact that the vehicle is moving through air, and the air through friction heats up. And because it heats up, it strips the atoms and the molecules of air itself, which of course are predominantly oxygen, but other gases such as nitrogen and so forth. And these then ionize. They, in fact, achieve a positive charge. And electromagnetic waves from radio beacons don't like ionized air. So they bounce off and they don't get through.
Oh, I see. Now, actually, for the controls, at this moment, are they still using those small rockets to control the
aircraft? Absolutely correct, yes. They're using the RCS system, as it's called, the reaction control system. And these little rockets are giving them their right attitude. But gradually, in fact, right at the moment as we talk, they're going to start entering into the aerodynamic phase. For example, the first thing that they will feel is they can roll the aircraft as it is now.
So their actual aircraft controls are now just beginning to take effect?
Absolutely correct.
Guy, thank you very much indeed. You're tuned to Radio 2. We're following the space shuttle right down. The actual landing time is scheduled for 22 minutes past 7 our time. But this is Radio 2. It's now exactly 7 o'clock.
It's counting down to acquisition of signal at the Buckhorn tracking station at Edwards. That's the first place where we will get telemetry. If Vandenberg's successful in bringing back up their system, we may get C-band radar ahead of that contact, ahead of that time. But we would not get voice communications or telemetry prior to about 2.5 minutes.
About 2.5 minutes to go before we get those vital radio signals from the spacecraft Columbia, which has now re-entered the atmosphere and should be at about 200,000 feet above the ground, about 560 miles off from touchdown at Edwards Air Force Base in California. A massive runway there.
We should be able to talk to the crew aboard Columbia.
2 minutes to go, a massive runway at Edwards Air Force Base, 6 miles long, constructed on a natural bed of a lake, a salt lake, very hard, nearly as hard as concrete, 6 miles long, 300 feet wide. You can hardly miss that. But just in case they do, the shuttle
towards the end of its glide down to Earth, will be escorted by a group of NASA fighters, which will show them the way, just in case there are visibility problems. Still waiting for that acquisition of the signal. And at Edwards Air Force Base, there are rescue crews standing by too, in case the craft were to fall short of the runway. But there is a tremendous overlap there, so it's unlikely. But if the craft has been damaged in any way during the intense heat of re-entry, then that is a possibility, as is the possibility of an emergency splashdown if it doesn't make it to the California coast. 1 minute to go before we acquire signals. It'll take about 2 minutes after we have those first radio communications with the spacecraft for the shuttle Columbia to cross over the California coast and begin its maneuvers to line up for the runway. Tremendous tension here at Mission Control as we await for those vital signals. We're rather expecting a cheer to go up as soon as we have them. Even if the astronauts decide to keep us in suspense for a little while longer, but if the radio systems on board are working, we will still know that the craft came through intact. And
range to go 402 nautical miles. Stand by for mark on 9,700 feet per second.
Hello, Columbia, Houston, there. How do you read? They've made it. They've made it through the atmosphere. We've had the first contact from the astronauts on board Columbia. Craft now at 165,000 feet, totally unpowered, no motors at this stage, no engines to boost them, coming in like a giant glider for a landing at Edwards Air Force Base in about, let me see, 12 minutes time from now. Well, much relief here on the ground at Mission Control in Houston. This is Andrew Mandelstam reporting. Now back to the studio.
Andrew, before we let you go there, in fact, we're not going to let you go until this thing is right on the ground, much jubilation. Was that actually a more important stage than the actual landing, or is it pretty vital both ways? Andrew Mandelstam. He's gone off listening to Mission Control. Goodness gracious. Well, Ian Ridpath is in our studio. Ian, far be it for me to say you're a second best, but we'll ask you here in London whether that was the most essential stage.
That was the most dangerous part of the whole mission. Once they were launched, once they were up, the real fear was that something might go wrong on re-entry. As we've been saying before, it's a craft which has never even had an unmanned test. It's a craft of a most peculiar shape. And it had to be controlled very carefully by computer, and there's those nagging doubts about the state of the tiles on the underside of the craft.
We didn't actually have any sort of note from them. Obviously it was too quick as to whether they felt a little overly warm or not, so it still could have been quite conceivable that a few of the tiles might have... I'm doubting the Americans' technology, I think, Andrew.
No, I don't think there's any problem. They are apparently just crossing the coast of California. I believe they are, in fact, within sight of the chase aircraft, which I presume should be sending back pictures of the shuttle, which shows that it is intact.
I wonder if we have Andrew Mandelstam at Mission Control again. No, we still don't have Andrew there. It'd be interesting to find out what that chase aircraft is doing. Surely this thing that's travelling, Ian, though, too fast for any chase aircraft operating on normal engines to get it.
They're being chased by T-38 trainers, which are supersonic jets. And once the craft gets close to Edwards...
We're hearing things from Mission Control.
That's right, lots of talk back from...
Are these the astronauts they're talking to at the moment?
Between communications between ground control and the astronauts. They are still now moving at faster than the speed of sound. It was said by ground control that people in Western California would probably hear sonic booms as the craft passed overhead, still moving at supersonic speed. But to go back and address the question that you asked, yes, that is the most dangerous part of the mission. It was one in which the astronauts were completely out of control. The computers were in command. The astronauts could do nothing. The space shuttle Columbia itself, or a previous space shuttle, a dummy space shuttle Enterprise, has been landed
by astronauts on a runway. But curiously enough, the crew of Shuttle Columbia, Young and Crippen, have not actually landed the shuttle, even in those tests. They weren't involved. So this will be the first time that John Young has actually landed a real shuttle, though, of course, they've done plenty of practice in simulators.
Well, we have Andrew Manderstein once again at Mission Control. Andrew, obviously, much jubilation there, and it sounds as though they've been now chatting quite a lot to the astronauts. No discomfort from the astronauts. They're quite happy, are they? Good grief, we've lost him again.
I'm sorry, I didn't quite get that question. I was listening in to an African show. We've now got the first television pictures of the shuttle, which are coming through from an aircraft which is shadowing the Columbia. Can't really distinguish whether the shuttle is in good shape or not, but everybody here on the ground at Houston, everybody here is very pleased by the way the re-entry has been completed. They're now doing the first computer analysis of the re-entry stage, and they'll be watching in particular the heat graph, the heat in the vital areas of the craft at the re-entry, because as they hope to do future missions with this same craft, they want to establish whether any part of it has been damaged, whether the system which has been installed works correctly, and all other matters related to the entire project. Now, we hope in a few minutes about 2.5 minutes to get the first pictures from a land-based camera in California, and we hope also that we should actually see the craft visually about 2 minutes before touchdown at Edwards Air Force Base, where now the crowd is estimated at over 150,000. A very hot day, but clear visibility, absolutely excellent. In fact, the astronauts who will be controlling the craft manually for the last phase of the landing as it glides down to Edwards should have a clear view about 4 or 5 minutes before landing. So the chase escort planes will not be needed in their role as guiding aircraft or guiding lights. They will be there purely to monitor the descent, to take photographs, and to help with the communications.
Mission Control has just said that the Shuttle Columbia is coming right down the chute. They're at Mach 3 now, that's three times the speed of sound, at an altitude of below 100,000 feet, which means that if anything should go wrong from here on, the astronauts are able to eject.
So that's it. I mean, they're home and hosed, in fact. They're safe. Nothing can really harm them at this stage, unless of course they nose the thing into the ground, which is most unlikely, I guess.
The last 4 minutes is going to be vital, because the mission controller said they're coming right down the chute, which means they're on the right glide path, so they're coming in at the right angle. We hope they're coming in at the right speed, but John Young will take over about at an altitude of about 5 or 6 miles. He will then pilot over the last 4 minutes. He will turn the craft after they've passed over Edwards Air Force Base, moving from west to east. He will then bank the craft right round so that it's going back in the other direction, and he will try and bring it down at a speed of about 200 miles an hour onto that runway. But as we've said, if he misses the runway, it's a dry lake bed. It's an enormous area of desert, so he has plenty of room left or right, or if he falls short or if he overruns, he's got plenty of room. And that's why they're landing it there rather than at the Kennedy Space Center in Florida, which is where future space shuttle missions will return to.
Well, it's just over 5 minutes to go before it is due to land. Andrew, do they know what speed the thing's traveling at this stage? Andrew Manderstam, are you there?
Yes, and we've now got the first visual contact with the craft from a television camera, and you can distinguish the wings, which are now, of course, keeping the craft up as it is transformed from a space shuttle into a large glider. An amazing transformation, a plane, a craft that went up like a rocket, now coming down like a jet airliner, like those airliners that you take on your holidays, a Trident or a BAC-111, or the Americans have compared it to their own DC-9 jet. Looks very stable, and all the radio contacts that we have here on the ground at Houston indicate that stability.
They should just now be coming over Edwards Air Force Base.
Flight to Kate Kennedy say that she's a wonderful flight, a wonderful craft to manage. They love her very much. She's an easy plane to maneuver, and that seems to be borne out by the way the craft is coming in now. It's dead on track. It'll be guided down to the runway not only by visual contact, but also by a system of microwave links which will keep the craft dead straight onto the approach.
Ian, everything is obviously running terribly smoothly. This thing is actually more, really, a plane, obviously, than a rocket. You could actually just fly it around if it had an engine on it now.
Yes, it is now an aeroplane. It's acting as a glider. Now, that's the important point now, where John Young takes over from the computers, which has been guiding it down on the glide path. They're just going into the banking turn. They've flown over Edwards Air Force Base, where the ground cameras have been able to see it. They've had a look at their landing site, so they certainly know that they're pretty much on the button. They know that where they have to get down to is below them.
So it's almost like an ordinary aircraft doing a circuit of the airfield at this stage, is it?
Yes, except that you have to think of it as a glider, not as an ordinary aircraft.
Now, this is rather the important thing. They have one chance at this landing. Of course, they can't put on power and start off again.
That's right. They have no engines which will now operate.
Right on the money,
they're saying. So John Young is bringing it round in the final turn.
Is this a lack of technology, by the way? They could have actually put more rocket fuel in so they could press a button and go around again if it went wrong. Could they not? Technologically speaking.
They would need to put extra engines in. It would all add to the weight of the thing, which you want to try and cut down the weight so you can increase the weight of the payload.
What's it made of? Is it terribly light or very heavy?
It's made of aluminium. It's built in very much the same way as an ordinary aircraft is.
0.6, range 13 miles.
13 miles from touchdown, John Young.
22,000 feet.
22,000 feet. Okay, so they should be moving at about 380 knots.
So that's in. It's getting down to almost at this stage an ordinary aircraft, isn't it? In the speed, the height, and everything.
Right on the glide slope, they say. Yes, this is now the same part. This is now the part of the landing which has been practiced by the astronauts before.
It's an incredibly exciting moment. The thing is just about on its final approach at this stage.
Yes. The chase planes are right alongside it. They're being able to take pictures of it. The chase planes will be able to tell the astronauts that they are coming in at the right speed and at the right angle. And it's all up to the piloting skills of John Young.
So in fact, in just over a minute from now, the Space Shuttle Columbia will be on the ground. Will they actually reuse it? I mean, are they going to? I know it technically is supposed to be.
That's the whole point. It should be.
It couldn't be any better.
It couldn't be any better. Well, they should be able to reuse it in next September. It's intended to be the next time when it's used next, but.
Well, the time now is coming up to 20 minutes past 7. In less than three quarters of a minute, the space shuttle should be on the ground. And now, in fact, for the landing, we're going to cross back to Andrew Mandelstam at Mission Control in Houston.
This is Andrew Mandelstam reporting from Mission Control in Houston on the completion of what appears to be a totally successful flight of the Columbia Space Shuttle. The craft now coming in, gliding into land at Edwards Air Force Base, proceeding at about 250 miles an hour. The undercarriage will come out in a few minutes. Remember that this craft has got no power on board at this stage at all. It really is gliding in, but we're told that it's right on the flight path, exactly where it should be at this stage. At any moment now, we should see it actually touch down on the runway at Edwards Air Force Base. It's just coming down. Tremendous excitement here at Mission Control. The wheels are now down. 30, 20, 10. And any time now, she is literally hovering on the 5 mile long runway at Edwards. And there she goes. We have now got a successful flight of the Columbia. Let's join Mission Control.
3, touchdown. Come on.
Tremendous applause, and those traditional cigars are being lit up here at Mission Control. I should remind people that during the Apollo launches, a lot of the technicians had cigars in their breast pockets, and they've all now come up on the successful completion of the shuttle mission. Craft now slowing down. We won't see the astronauts actually come out of the shuttle for another 45 minutes or so. They will check through their controls, be debriefed, and they've also got to make quite sure that no dangerous gases are built up within the craft, that there's no radiation on the outside. And the craft has now come to a standstill.
and clouds of dust, of the sandy, salty dust of this makeshift runway, which is as hard as concrete, incidentally, now dissipating, and much relief is being felt. We're waiting to hear a radio contact.
Houston, the unofficial touchdown time, 2 days, 6 hours, 20 minutes, 52 seconds. 2 days, 6 hours, 20 minutes, 52 seconds.
And Columbia, Houston, we're estimating at least 26 more minutes on the ammonia. You're looking real good.
Well, there you are, the official time mark for the end of the first ever reusable spacecraft mission.
Touch the lake bed. The flight director's instructions were prepare for acceleration.
Prepare for acceleration, indeed. And much festivities here at Houston at Cape Canaveral, where the craft was launched last Sunday, and of course at Edwards Air Force Base. This is Andrew Mandelsam reporting from Mission Control in Houston. Now back to the studio.
Andrew, obviously, huge excitement. What happens now?
Well, what happens now is the debriefing period. We will have a continual chit-chat between the astronauts and the control here in Houston. Then the astronauts will leave the craft in about 40 minutes' time. They will make a short speech. We hope, we've been promised they will at least, using microphones which have been specially installed near the craft by NASA, part of a radio and a television pool. We won't be able to ask them any questions at this stage of the operation. Later, they will be flown back to Houston, arriving in the early hours of the morning, British time, tomorrow morning. Again, no press conference as such. They'll be reunited with their families. The first time that we have the opportunity of actually asking them any questions will probably be in about a week from now, when they have ended their intensive briefing.
Andrew, this is Ian Ridpath in the LBC Space Studio in London. One thing that surprised me was that they seemed to, firstly, they were a little bit early, they were about 20 or 30 seconds early, and also the craft did not roll on for anywhere near as long as was expected. It seemed to come to quite an easy stop. Was that your impression as well there?
We seem to have lost contact again with Andrew Mandelsam. He's having great difficulty hearing us, actually.
I'm
Yeah, we can bring spaceships down to ground quite safely, but the telephone links between America and London, no way can we get
I
that
I would
right.
imagine that he's deafened by the cheering at Mission Control in Houston. One of the interesting things about astronaut John Young was that not only had he not actually landed the real space shuttle, the test flights were made by other astronauts who would fly later missions, but also he had to do it after having spent 2 days weightless. Now that's rather interesting. Astronauts in previous spacecraft just had to sit there. After the spacecraft came through the atmosphere, they came down on parachutes and they splashed down into the atmosphere. There wasn't really very much for them to do, but John Young had to become a pilot in unaccustomed full Earth gravity after having spent 2 days weightless. I think he's done an absolutely marvellous job, and by all accounts he seemed to have made a better attempt at landing the space shuttle from a height of 175 miles and a speed of 17,000 miles an hour than many touchdowns I see at London Airport.
It's a brilliant touchdown. But this thing of weightlessness, I thought that years and years and years ago they'd got over any worries that that might have on the human body, so to speak.
There are no worries. There's certainly no long-term ill effects that you suffer from weightlessness. But, of course, a man has to readjust. He spends 2 days in weightlessness. As we said, he's not a young man. He's 50 years old, and he certainly needed all his test pilot experience. After 2 days in weightlessness, it's a little different for a person to readjust to the full pull of Earth's gravity and still operate as a successful pilot. He was sitting there with his hand on the control stick, rather like a joystick. He was having to push his legs on the rudder pedals to operate the rudders, and certainly there were no ill effects of weightlessness. It's absolutely marvelous success. I'm delighted, and it certainly augurs well for the future space shuttle missions, although we have to see how that heat shield has stood up.
We're going back to Andrew Mandelsam at Mission Control Houston for just a minute. Andrew, I guess they're actually gathering around this craft now, or what are they doing?
Yes, there's some very strange-looking men in special chemical-resistance suits actually hovering around the ground, hovering around the spacecraft. They're going to be testing to see whether there has been any radiation collected on the exterior, having a look at the tiles, those tiles which caused so much concern earlier when we thought that some of them may have dropped off, but quite obviously
none of any importance have, otherwise the craft wouldn't be sitting there comfortably on the runway at Edwards Air Force Base. And then they've also got to check out the various gases inside the craft, because there could be some either explosive or poisonous gases there trapped within the shuttle, and they would have to extract that before the astronauts can come out. I'm told that in any case, the astronauts are no longer in isolation. They can actually talk to people, shake hands, and do all sorts of things that they haven't been able to do prior to the actual shuttle liftoff. But they won't be seeing anybody really at this stage except for the NASA officials themselves. There's no news conference planned for about another week or so, but we're still waiting for them to come out and make their speech. And possibly even, we're told, take a telephone conversation from President Reagan or Vice President Bush at the White House. That would be the tradition. That's what used to happen anyway during the Apollo moonshot.
Andrew, thank you very much. Andrew Manderstam at Mission Control in Houston. Certainly a day for the Americans. Ian Ridpath, just before we let you go to this thing, you know, we've heard about, I'm being cynical for the final moment, that American aircraft built have shown stress, cracks in wings and things like that. Will they check this thing now, over now, totally, for that sort of thing?
Oh, yes. That's why it's not being flown again until September. When the shuttle starts flying full operational missions, they hope they'll be able to turn it round in about 2 weeks. It's rather like any airline, the faster you turn round your aircraft, the more cost-effective they become. But certainly they're going to have to check over those tiles. There are no reports at the moment of any untoward tile loss during the landing. So I think things are looking good for shuttle missions after all.
This has been LBC reporting the Columbia Space Shuttle. Very shortly, London Life.
This week, the Royal Opera House Easter programme includes Swan Lake, Les Sylphides, Hamlet, Frederick Ashton's highly acclaimed Rhapsody, and the award-winning production of Wagner's Lohengrin. Seats are still available for some performances. Ring 01-240-1066 now. Or come to the Royal Opera House box office from 10 a.m. tomorrow. If we can fit you in, we will.
The next time you need new clothes, go to Harry Reid's, the menswear shop in Bridge Street, Pinner, Middlesex, and find out what shopping should really be like. Because in Harry Reid's, the customer is the most important person. You're treated with respect, and your wishes are what matter. And Harry Reid's gives choice. Come and see our extensive range of suits, trousers and shirts, and the new spring and summer lines, all by leading manufacturers and at very competitive prices. Harry Reid's of Pinner, where shopping is as it ought to be.
The god Pan lives and demons rule. Take care, poor mortals all. They're moving ever nearer, spreading terror, fear and gall in darkest pits and slimy holes. Horned head and arrow tail, screaming skulls and tortured souls. Pandemonium! A new diabolical exhibition opens within the London dungeon this month. Pandemonium.
LBC News at 7:30. America's space shuttle has landed safely on a dry lake bed at an Air Force base in California at the end of Columbia's historic space flight, the first successful flight of a usable spaceship. Tension reached its peak just before 7:10 when the crew finally broke radio silence after re-entering the Earth's atmosphere, during which its underside heat shield reached a temperature of more than 1,200 degrees Fahrenheit. Environment Secretary Michael Heseltine says Lambeth Council will get immediate cash aid from the government to clear up after the Brixton riots. Mr. Heseltine says the council has overspent so much in the past they don't qualify for financial aid. The government says the condition of IRA hunger striker Bobby Sands is deteriorating, but the Northern Ireland office says the newly elected MP's condition isn't giving cause for concern at the moment. The civil service unions claim an overwhelming response to their call for an all-out strike this afternoon. They say 85% of their 500,000 members walked out in protest at the Navy's action in resupplying the Polaris submarine Resolution. But the government says only 50% didn't turn up for work around the country. London's weather, we can expect some heavy showers overnight, perhaps with thunder at times, and a minimum temperature of 9 degrees centigrade, 48 degrees Fahrenheit. And the outlook is for some showers continuing tomorrow morning, but brightening up in the afternoon. Now sport, horse racing, and there were three meetings today. With the results, here's Jeff Stelling.
It's 9 o'clock, this is Bill Bingham.
The shuttle has landed. After roaring red hot through the outer layers of the Earth's atmosphere at 17,000 miles an hour, it glided soundlessly to a dried lake bed at Edwards Air Force Base in California to make a textbook landing. Reporter Bob Foss was among the crowd of 200,000 who watched the world's first reusable spacecraft come back to Earth.
We see it now. Jim, we see it, and the shuttle is coming down as we expected. It's coming down at a very steep angle, which is the way it's supposed to. That's really quite a sight out there. It's coming in. We have a really clear view of it, and the landing gear are down. Landing gear appear to be down. It's just about to touch down, just about to touch down. It's going to be those rear wheels to touch down first. Its nose is kind of up in the air. It's really a spectacular sight. Those rear wheels just did touch down. Now the front of the shuttle is just kind of very gently rolling forward. That shuttle is still moving pretty fast, and there's an awful lot of dust trailing behind it. The nose wheel is down. The space shuttle has landed. What a magnificent sight it is out here.